First on Four, a tribute to a chorister who made a world-famous gramophone record nearly 70 years ago.
It's like part of the English way of life. It's like the teddy bear's picnic. It's like the BBC. It's like cornflakes.
But there it was, and I used to play it so often, and I was very, very influenced by it.
I'm trying to remember when I first heard the record. It was probably when I was about 9 or 10, and singing as a boy treble myself. Not a particularly good one, but good enough, I think, for my school music master to say, listen to this. This is how a boy's voice should sound. This, in fact, is how a boy should sing.
We would literally sit round the fire at home with the governor's gramophone, and he would play for us some of those magical 78 records, which were his pride and joy. And the song that I always remember, the piece that I always remember, was Over the Wings of a Dove.
It was being played, of course, all the time on the radio as well. And it was very important because being a singer, a boy soprano, I suppose I must have modelled myself rather on him too.
Whenever I hear choristers' voices, I always hear Ernest Lough's disembodied voice somewhere.
Presenting to him the honorary diploma of Fellow of the Royal School of Church Music.
Ernest Lough received his fellowship award for a lifetime of music making, but for most people he is remembered for just one record. For them, he is still Master Ernest Lough, the boy who sang Over the Wings of a Dove.
Until a few years ago in the choir of the Temple Church and still in the Bach Choir.
Ernest Lough is my father. When I was a boy, I sang with him in the same church where he made his famous recordings 30 years earlier. And even then, I was daunted by his reputation as the greatest chorister of them all. Today, I still meet people who say, I remember Over the Wings of a Dove. We used to play it when we were children. And it continues to amaze me that a gramophone record made in 1927, when recording techniques were very much in their infancy, should continue to remain as popular as it has. I wanted to find out why that record is still with us, and why a venture that started out as a very modest and unambitious recording of a London church choir should have become one of the most successful records of all time. The story of Ernest Lough's musical life began in 1923, when he came to London in search of a place in a cathedral choir. Even then, London was a city of traffic jams, but in those days the men wore hats. Amazingly, given what was to follow, he was turned down at his first audition at Southwark Cathedral, and it was only when he came here, to the Temple Church in Fleet Street, that he was offered a place as a chorister. The Temple Choir of the 1920s was already renowned for producing a succession of fine boy sopranos under the guidance of its young choirmaster, George Thalben Ball, known affectionately as Doctor to generations of choir boys. It was a tradition he had only recently inherited from Sir Henry Walfer Davis. Ernest Lough, already 12 years old, was starting comparatively late for a boy soprano. Now in his 80s, my father returned to the Temple Church recently with the writer and broadcaster Jeremy Nicholas, who has made a study of the Temple Choir and those early recordings. The Temple Church, like the Temple Choir, is administered and paid for by the barristers and judges of the Inns of Court at the Inner and Middle Temple, and it was the musical interest of one particular judge, Lord Justice Banks, that led to that first recording.
We used to sing Hear My Prayer. It was in the normal services. Only about once a year, but we did it. And it was at that point that Lord Justice Banks said to Dr. Pity we can't hear that more often. The doctor said, you can, if you make a record of it. Simple as that.
Thalben Ball was aware of the recent advances in recorded sound, and his desire to put his own choir on record coincided with HMV's introduction of their first mobile recording van. The choir had three soloists at the time, Doug Horton, Ron Mallett, and Ernest Lough. And it was my father whose voice was judged to be in the best condition on the day of the recording.
Now, where did you actually make the record? Here, presumably.
Well, here, yes.
Where did they put the microphone?
Well, there was one microphone here.
Yeah.
We took the organ. We were all on this side, on the cantori side, two rows of boys. I was there at the back, and the gentlemen were behind in these raked pews. And the head boy, who was Ron Mallett, was at the end there. And he was more or less the chap in charge. We took all our nods and starts from him. No conductor.
No conductor?
No conductor at all, no. So, doctor on the organ, Ron Mallett in charge of the choir, more or less, stopping, starting, everything for him. And the man stood here, and as the red light came on, he used to raise his hand. And when the wax was beginning to turn, he'd lower his hand, Ron would start us. And Ron would finish us. It's all done by him.
Singing your solo, you weren't given a specific microphone or anything like that?
No. But I was so small that I had to stand on a couple of Bibles behind there to be up above, because these lights weren't there then. They were tall lights. So I was raised up a bit higher, but that was all. The trouble was, you see, when you did a wax recording, doctor used to say, "That's a good one, we'll keep that." And when he meant keep it, you never hear it again. So the black tape, you can play it back and say, yes, I could do this or that better. With wax, discs, once it started and once it stopped, that was that. You never heard it again, not until it came out published.
Pretty nerve-wracking.
I thought it was, yes.
Were you actually made the record?
About 14, 14 and a half.
14 and a half. Quite old for a treble, one would think, these days.
Yes. We were more matured, shall we say. We could understand better what we were doing the older we get. But we had to do it again, you know. We did it three times. The first time they brought their machine up here and we did the recording, the machine broke down. And then we did another one about 3 weeks later, which was the official one. Mm. And then, because the wax was worn out at the time they made so many pressings, we had to do it again in the November. So in that time, between March and November, my voice had changed a wee bit. I know it did. It got to be really, it got fruity, more fruity. So I know the difference between those two, but I don't think many people would know the difference.
What I'm really impressed with Ernest, is the fact that he sings in the most perfect bel canto manner. It's basically the voice never portamentos upwards, so you're always singing absolutely cleanly going up. And you're always slightly portamento down, so every note is joined on the way down. And this is pure bel canto, I mean, the golden age of singing. This is what they were taught in 1700 and on. This great line which is never stops. And again, Ernest never stops the note until it stops. So in many ways, it's perfect singing.
I don't think you could do it today. You know, I mean, they'd probably have a microphone up your nose and, you know, everything would be very tightly mic'd, as opposed to one mic, you know, which they appear to have then. I just don't think they could reproduce that again, ever, ever, ever.
I think was released in June 1927.
Yes.
So how soon afterwards were you aware of that special attention was going to be paid to you?
Well, I don't think I was ever aware of it, except in practical terms, the number of letters that came in. Letters every day, every week. Also, the fact that people used to come here to the church either to hear the choir or see me or something. It was so bad that the benches had to issue tickets. But they had to restrict that because people used to come in and stand on these plush pews to see the choir. And we think, what's all that fuss about? We've got our homework to do.
But success inevitably led to some very strange rumours.
When I was in goal for one side, standing here, these two old ladies came up and said, did I know where they were, where they could leave the money for the Lough Memorial Fund, you see, that was after we made Hear My Prayer. I said, well, what's happened to him? He said, oh, he's dead, didn't you know? There's a memorial for him. I said, well, I think he's alive. He said, how do you know? He said, well, because I'm him. You know, they said, wretched boys, and walked away.
there was a rumour going around after you made the record that you died.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Really?
Mm. Lots of them. I got letters, one beautiful one from South Africa. A chap who said he knew me well in the choir, and he'd heard I'd died because they'd seen a picture of me in my cassock and surplice at a poster in a gramophone shop saying the last record of Ernest Lough. Well, it was the last record, but not the last.
The last. So, the sort of angelic. I suppose, yes, because on all those record sleeves of you, you do appear as a rather angelic thing, don't you?
Yes. Oh, I died of everything, you know, broken arm, broken leg, broken anything, you name it. Anyhow, that was a long time ago.
HMV, encouraged by the enormous success of O for the Wings of a Dove, went on to make seven more discs with Ernest Lough and the Temple Choir, but none of them was as popular as that first recording. There was, however, one recording, Mendelssohn's Hear Ye Israel, which remains my father's favourite performance to this day, and the fact that it was recorded at all was something of an accident.
The choir had a session on a Saturday morning, and at the end of it, the engineer in the band said, we've got a spare wax. Have you got anything which will fit onto a 10-inch wax, two sides? So the doctor said, well, the choir's got nothing in rehearsal, so they must go, they've got a big service tomorrow. He said to me, is there anything you know which will fit on a 10-inch wax? And I said, no. He said, well, let's go and have a look. We walked around the practice room out there where all the books were stacked up. And he's going around, he said, do you know Hear Ye Israel from Elijah? I said, no. He said, well, let's have a look at it. He got it copied down. We went through it. Within about half an hour, he said, I think we can record that, don't you? He put me down there, right on the corner of the round church, with a microphone. And we made the first test of it for balance. It was all right. Then we did a master. And the engineer said, we'll take that one, and that's the record we've got down. It was just, doctor, this is a way to sing it. marking where you breathe, where you don't breathe, emphasize this, don't do that. It was as simple as that.
Half an hour from start to finish.
It's a fairly straightforward solo. It's a bit operatic.
You'd never seen it before.
Yeah. And that's not showing off. It's just Doctor's ability to teach me, certainly getting a bit older then, how to sing this work, and he played it through. He went up there and played the organ, and it worked. It was a miracle.
The song and the singer were absolutely inseparable. And I can think of very, very few occasions in the classical realm where that happens. And it's always made me feel terribly sorry for boy trebles who had to follow that record. Because now if someone records it, everyone says, oh, that's Over the Wizard of a Dove, or that comes from Hear My Prayer. But they never say that is Master Boom Boom singing it. And I think that's quite rare.
Can you remember your reaction when your voice broke? Can you remember the day your voice broke and you thought, well, I'm not going to be singing Over the Wings of a Dove anymore?
Yes, quite clearly, because we'd done the rehearsal in the morning, and when we went to the practice room for further rehearsal before the service, Doctor said to me, Ron Mallett, both head boys, one on Decano, one on Cantoise, come and sit down. So we went and sat down, and what's the matter? I was singing all right this morning. And he, before they went to the service, he said, there's a sign of getting tired. So from that point, I didn't sing anymore in the choir as a boy. We knew it was going to happen. There's nothing unnatural about boys getting older, dropping out. And so we weren't suddenly confronted with a broken voice. We knew it was going to happen. Thank God it did, to some extent. So it was a thing we accepted. We knew it was going to happen. There was no kind of thing, oh, my God, it's the end. It's not the end at all.
In spite of the fact that Ernest Lough had become something of a household name, he was now faced with the reality of living the rest of his life after his voice broke, and his first task was to find work in depression-hit Britain.
I applied for jobs when I left school, and HMV wrote back and said, well, you can start in the advertising department at so much a week. Report on Monday if you like.
But they must have said, not the Ernest Lough on our record.
No mention of that. I think they more or less ignored it. I wasn't ever conscious that Ernest Lough meant anything more than the chap down there who's making the tea to start with and posting blocks and doing all the wrapping up, all that kind of stuff. The real basics required by that department. And whether I sang or not didn't matter to them.
What did matter to HMV was that he made more records for them. And less than a decade after his voice broke, my father returned to the microphone as a baritone.
Could I only tell thee how dear thou art to me? Show thee my heart's devotion, say how I worship thee. The height of stars above thee, the deepness of the sea. The height and deepness of my heart's love for thee. Love, could I only tell thee how dear thou art to me.
Recently married to his childhood sweetheart and sometime accompanist, my father entered the war as part of the home defences. Fatefully, it took him back to the Temple Church, but not as a singer.
I was in the fire service during the war, and one of the jobs we were on was the St Paul's Cathedral, back of it, which was blitzed badly and well alight. And while we were there,
the officer came along and said, right, make up, you lot, and get back down to the temple. And we came down here to back up the team, and the place was alight. The whole church was alight, all this was alight, all that. And we, with our little appliance, was trying to do something about it, you see. And there's no water, because the hydrants were all down, all blitzed. And they said, well, try and get some water from the Thames. And of course, the time we got down the Thames, the tide was out, so there was no water there. We really had to stand here and watch it burn.
This is you coming back to save the church that you've been singing in for the previous 20 years.
And to watch it burn was terrible.
The Temple Church and the adjacent Inner Temple Hall were badly damaged by incendiary bombs, and for a while, the 800-year history of the church, together with its musical tradition, appeared to have come to an end. While the bombs continued to fall, the legendary documentary filmmaker Humphrey Jennings was at work on his series of films about the war effort.
Crown Film Unit made documentary films. They decided to make one of the fire service during the Blitz period, and they selected Harrow, where I was stationed, for the crew, the machines, and the officers. I was selected to be the officer in charge of the control room. And we had to go to Pinewood for the film, and it was in this vast studio, but there was a little tiny section which was the fire service control room.
Control? Right. Fire at Dock Street, sub.
Send a TP from V, a TP from W, send a heavy and a TP from X.
Order a trailer pack.
And a TP from Z. Get District Officer Blythe to go on, will you?
Order 1TP to Trinidad Street.
Control here. Order your heavy unit and trailer pack to Trinidad Street.
Back in the real war, my father found that fighting fires occasionally produced some curious surprises.
I was with the appliance sent on a job at Elephant Castle. When we got there, we found it was a record factory with all the records stored in. So we went in with our hoses, and the first record I picked up was that, which you can see if you can very carefully.
It's
Hear My Prayer.
Hear My Prayer. And that was lying on the floor burning as you went in to save the building.
So we rescued it, thinking it would be a memento of some kind, but. Thank we all our gods on the other side. That's another record in the middle there.
Another record's got glued to it. Oh,
there
wonderful.
It is, and I've kept it.
In spite of the terrible damage to the temple and the evacuation of the choir boys, my father, now one of the gentlemen of the choir, continued to sing in the Sunday services which were held in the bombed-out ruins of the church. For the coronation of Elizabeth II in 1953, the choirs of Westminster Abbey, St. Paul's, the Temple, and the Chapel Royal were combined, and it brought together my father and my older brother Peter, a chorister at the Chapel Royal St. James's. Returning to Westminster Abbey 40 years later brings back some vivid memories of that historic day.
Now, we must have been
somewhere around here.
We were around here, weren't we? The choirs were all up there. The orchestra was on the top of that screen. Do you remember?
We were right at the top there. Those arches, we were... I could touch those arches each side.
Yeah, and all that. The whole area was the choir, wasn't it?
Sir William Mackay was up there, wasn't he, conducting?
Yes.
And we couldn't see his beat up the top there, so we had it second hand from Eddie Wright, who was just above here. And they had the same this side, so it came from Sir William Mackay to Eddie Wright to us.
Rejoice, 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 rejoice.
Could you see any of the coronation from the back where you were?
Well, only between two pillars, which was just the bit of the coronation chair.
But you weren't supposed to be looking at the coronation. Remember them telling us we were here?
I couldn't look anywhere else.
Not as spectators, but to perform.
Work was well underway on the rebuilding of the Temple Church by the appropriately named Dove Brothers, and with the reopening of part of the church in 1954, George Thorburn-Ball set about assembling a new choir with the reintroduction of boys. I was the youngest member of that new choir, and I think I knew even then that I had a hard act to follow.
I used to stand here, and my father, who was by then a baritone, stood directly behind me, and Dr. George Thorburn-Ball was still the organist and choir master when I was a soloist, but I never sang any of the solos that my father sang, which I think was probably a good thing because there was no comparison. I used to sing like any other choir boy, but he was something special. There was one duet that I sang that he also sang, I Waited for the Lord, which I sang with a boy called Ian LeGrice, and my father had recorded with Ron Mallett, and it's the only example there is of the two voices singing the same thing.
The remarkable thing about these two recordings, made 30 years apart, is that the organist and choirmaster is the same on both. George Thorburn-Ball took over the Temple Choir when he was still only 28, and for many years he was regarded as the finest organist in the world. Knighted in 1982, he was not only the organist and choirmaster of the Temple Church for nearly 60 years, but was also the city organist here in Birmingham. George Thorburn-Ball and Ernest Lough received gold discs in 1963, not for selling a million copies of Over the Wings of a Dove, but in celebration of its 35th anniversary. Nobody knows how many copies have been sold. It's been estimated at over 5 million, but whatever the figures, no one, my father included, got rich because of it. The kind of wealth enjoyed by recording stars today could not have been imagined in the early days of the wind-up gramophone.
When my partner Brian Forbes wrote this screenplay based on the original story, there was created this mythical figure of Arthur, which was Kim Stanley's supposed child, which was a total fabrication of her imagination. This poor, deranged, slightly demented woman found the most wonderful peace and serenity listening to this magical voice. Now, the voice came after the screenplay, and it came by virtue of the fact that I had a father who was immensely musical. He wasn't a musician as such, he was an academic, but he absolutely loved music. And he would play for us some of those magical 78 records. And one of them was your father singing. And the song that I always remember, the piece that I always remember, was Over the Wings of a Dove, in that it had a purity and an innocence and a nostalgia, feeling of nostalgia, of yearning for this past, this image, which was so magical. And the moment Forbesy and I got this idea of attaching it to this subject, the subject changed its very ambiance. Whenever I think of Sales, I hear the movie, which is a strange thing to say about a film, but I hear the film before I see it because of your father's voice.
Read this to me, will you? I want to hear how it sounds. You use this in case we want to make corrections.
You want to read it out loud, do you?
Yes.
Well, could we have that a little quieter, please?
I wish you weren't such a bore about good music.
My younger brother Graham followed my father into the Temple Choir, still under George Thorburn Ball, and today they sing side by side among the basses of the Bach Choir.
It's a funny thing about singing, because it's a wonderful thing to do on your own if you're good enough to do it on your own, and it's the most profound human expression of music that you can have, in a sense. And if Ernest, after a distinguished career as a boy, then felt the desperate urge, as we all do, to go on singing, he would naturally, depending on how the voice broke, want to do that within the confines of a choir. Then I suppose, after many, many years of doing that, you say 40 years or so of doing that, then maybe he felt the need to hide himself away even more amongst a choir of 300 voices. But that in itself presents another tremendous thrill to somebody who loves using the human voice.
Make sure each time it's a lay son, a quick S, not Zon, but son, from everybody there. Once more, basses, your lead, 3, 4. He went through the same audition as anybody else. It certainly didn't hurt him that he was Ernest Lough, and it didn't hurt him that I knew of him, because I knew that he'd been well trained as a boy, and I knew that he'd been singing regularly throughout his life in the temple to a very high standard. And a person like that who's been trained so well is going to keep his voice to a very late age. Once you've been trained as well as Ernest was as a boy, and if you've kept it up through your life, you're going to go on for a very long time singing well. He isn't alone in being able to sing well at the age of 80, because I knew Sir Keith Faulkner, who's a very distinguished bass soloist. He also was singing magnificently right into his 80s. So it shows the value of good training at a young age and practice throughout your life.
I feel when I listen to Ernest again that he is very much the end of a tremendously important long tradition. And I think people could now listen to these records of him and really learn a fantastic amount
about the technique of singing.
It's just wondrous that your father was put onto disc, where, you know, at a time when it was such an things were at such an optimum in terms of his voice and the way it was recorded. It was just the most one of the most extraordinary things I think I've ever heard, and will always be with me.
Over the Wings of a Dove was probably the most surprising success in the history of recording. Nobody planned it, and nobody expected it. Certainly not my father. To him, it was just a job, something he had been trained to do. The hardest part, in a way, was what followed, trying to lead a normal life. He once said, "Boy sopranos must die young." And while that's true, he also exemplifies the very opposite of that remark. Like Peter Pan, he is, and always will be, eternally young, his image, like his voice, frozen in time by those early recordings. And maybe, ultimately, that is the key to it all. For everyone who has come into contact with that record, there is a feeling that is more than mere nostalgia. It's a fleeting moment of beauty that touches all of us at some deep inner level, but leaves no more than an echo in its wake.